In this video, we are going to discuss about two important application layer protocols, SNMP and DNS protocols. So first we will discuss about SNMP protocol and later we will see about DNS protocol. We first discuss the general idea behind the network management. We then introduce the client-server application, SNP, that is used for the purpose in the internet. We can define network management as monitoring, testing, configuring, and troubleshooting network components to meet set of requirements defined by an organization. These requirements include the smooth, efficient operations of the network that provides the predefined quality of service for users. To accomplish this task, a network management system uses hardware, software, and humans. We can say that the functions performed by network management system can be divided into five broad categories: configuration management, fault management, performance management, security management, and accounting management. So, which is shown in the figure. The simple network management protocol, that is SNMP, is a framework for managing a devices in an internet using the TCP/IP protocol suite. It provides a set of fundamental operations for monitoring and maintaining an internet. SNP is an application level protocol in which a few manager stations control a set of agents. A management station called a manager is a host that runs the SNMP client program. A managed station called an agent is a router that runs the SNMP server programs. Management is achieved through simple interaction between manager and an agent. The agent keeps performance information in a database. The manager has access to the value in the database. For example, a router can store in appropriate variables the number of packets received and forwarded. The manager can fetch and compare the value of these two variables to see if the router is congested or not. So SNMP management is based on three basic ideas. A manager checks an agent by requesting information that reflects the behavior of the agent. A manager forces an agent to perform a task by resetting values in the agent database. And an agent contributes to the management process by warning the manager of an unusual situations. To do management task, SNMP uses two other protocols. The first one is Structure of Management Information, SMI. And the next one is Management Information Base, MIB. In other words, management on the internet is done through the cooperation of three protocols: SNMP, SMI, and MIB. So we will see one by one what is the role of these three protocols. The role of SNMP, Simple Network Management Protocol. SNMP has some very specific roles in network management. It defines the format of the packet to be sent from a manager to an agent and vice versa. It also interprets the result and creates statistics, often with the help of other management software. The packet exchanged contains the object, that is variable names, and their status. SNMP is responsible for reading and changing these values. So to define this, SNMP version 3 defines 8 types of packets, or we can tell it as protocol data units. So here we have the names are get request, get response, get next expert, get next response. Similarly, we have set response, set request, trap, inform request, and report, which is all shown in this figure. So here, get request, get next request, all these things are sent from SNMP manager to SNMP agent, and get response, set response, and trap, all these things sent from SNMP agent to the SNMP manager, which is also shown in the figure. The format for the 8 SNMP PDUs, which is shown in the figure here, the get bulk request PDU differs from other in two areas, which is also shown in the figure. SNMP does not send only a protocol data unit. It also embeds the PDU in a message. A message in Simple Network Main Protocol version 3 is made up of 4 elements: version, header, security parameters, and data, which includes the encoded PDU. So SNMP uses both SMI and MIB in Internet Network Management. It is an application program that allows a manager to retrieve the value of an object defined in an agent, a manager to store a value in an object defined in an agent, and agent send an alarm messages about an abnormal situation to the manager. Next, we'll see the role of SMI. To use SNMP, we need rules for naming object. This is particularly important because the object in SNMP form a hierarchical structure. An object may have a parent object and some children object. Part of a name can be inherited from the parent. We also need rules to define the type of object. That is, what type of objects are handled by SNMP. Can SNMP handle simple type or structure type? How many simple types are available? What are the sizes of these types? What is the range of these types? In addition, how are each of these types are encoded? We need these universal rules because we do not know the architecture of computer that send, receive, or store these values. The sender may be a powerful computer in which an integer is stored as 8-byte data. The receiver may be a small computer that stores an integer as a 4-byte data. SMI is a protocol that defines these rules. However, we must understand that SMI only defines the rule. It does not define how many objects are managed in an entity or which object uses which type. SMI is a collection of general rules to name object and to list their types. The association of an object with a type is not done by SMI. Next, we will see the role of MIB. We hope it is clear that we need another protocol. For each entity to be managed, this protocol must define the number of objects, name, them according to the rules defined by SMI and according to the and associate type to each named object. This protocol is MIB. MIB creates a set of objects defined for each entity similar to a database, mostly metadata in a database, name and types without values. So now we will see an analogy. Here we are going to compare of writing a program and the network management. So when we compare here, both tasks need rules, like how to write a program. For example, in C program, you need to declare the first you have to declare the variables, and then you have to define the or execute, and then you can have the executed statements. So it is going to be handled by SMI. Similarly, both tasks needs variable declarations. How many variables are going to be defined? In this, the network management it is going to handle by MID. Similarly, both tasks have to perform actions. It is going to be done by SNMP protocols. The structure of management information version 2 is a component for network management. The functions are to name object, to define the type of data that can be stored in an object, to show how to encode the data for transmission over the network. So we have a quick tour on what is a network management and what are the three different protocols that support the network management. We know that SMI protocol, which is going to name the object, and we have compared this with our program whenever you are going to define your variables. Similarly, the next one is the SMI can be abbreviated as structure of management informations. The next one is management information base, MIB, which is going to tell how many different variables are going to be used. And the last one is SNMP. SNMP protocol is a simple network management protocol, is going to have some action between the manager and the agent. So they are going to send either manager will send a request to the agent, or agent will send response to the manager. In this case, they are going to find whether the network is operating normal or whether any congestion occurs. All the basic network management operations will be executed in SNMP protocol. We are going to see the next popular application protocol is domain name system. Is a client server application that provide name services for other applications. It enables the use of application layer address such as email address instead of network layer logical address. So here we will have a small example. In this figure, we have many server. Every server have a corresponding IP address, which is represented in numeric format. However, people prefer to use name instead of numeric addresses. A user of an email or a website program may know the mail address of the recipient, but they only know the mail address but not the IP address. But we all know that IP protocol needs the IP address. So if we have IP address, then TCP/IP protocol uses this address to make the or to identify the connection of a host to the internet. So when you type website address, let me consider the example as https://facebook.com. But we all know only the name of the website, and it is not that much easy to remember the IP address. So in this case, DNS server domain name system will help us to identify the corresponding IP address. So you are going to send the input to the domain name server as your mail address or your website address. So after receiving this address, it will send the corresponding IP address to us. So using this IP address, your IP protocol will connect the host to the internet. So here we are going to use the domain name system, which is going to give the IP address when we type the corresponding website address or email address. So we have we can broadly classify the client server program into two categories: those that can be directly used by the user, such as email, and those that support other application programs. So here the domain name system is a supporting program which we cannot use directly. It is going to be used by the program such as email. The DNS client program sends a request to the DNS server to map the email address to the corresponding IP address. So we all know that normally in our mobile phones, we used to save the name. Whenever you are typing the name and making a call, automatically it will map the phone number to its name and the connection will be existed. But if our internet was small, so mapping was done by using a host file where we can have only two columns, name and address. Today, however, it is impossible to have one single host file to relate every address with a name and vice versa. So the host file would be too large to store in every host. In addition, it would be impossible to update all the host files every time there was a change. So for this, we can have a solution where we can store the entire host file in a simple computer and allow access to this centralized information to every computer that needs mapping. But we know that this would create a large amount of traffic on the internet. So another solution is that one we have used today is to divide the huge amount of information into smaller parts and store each part on a different computer. In this method, the host that needs mapping can contact the closest computer holding the needed information. This method is used by domain name system, and we will see in detail. So to be unambiguous, the name is assigned to machine must be carefully selected from a namespace with complete control over binding between the name and IP addresses. In other words, the name must be unique because the addresses are unique. A namespace that map each addresses to unique name can be organized in two ways: flat or hierarchical. In flat namespace, a name is assigned to an address. A name in this space is a sequence of character without any structure. The names may or may not have a comment section. If they do, it has no meaning. So the main disadvantage of the flat namespace is that it cannot be used in a large system such as internet, because it must be centrally controlled to avoid ambiguity and duplications. In a hierarchical namespace, each name is made of several parts. The first part can define the nature of the organization. The second part can define the name of an organization. The third part can define the department in the organization, and so on. In this case, the authority to assign and control namespaces can be decentralized. A central authority can assign the part of the name that defines the nature of organization and the name of the organization. The responsibility of the rest of the name can be given to organization itself. The organization can add suffixes to the name to define its host or resources. So now we are using hierarchical namespaces in domain name system. So to do this, we are going to have a domain namespace was designed. In this design, the names are defined in an inverted T structure with the root at the top, which is shown in figure. The tree can have only 128 level, that is from level 0 to level 127. So in domain namespace, we have two important parts. The first one is label. Each node in the tree has a label, which is a string with a maximum of 63 characters. Always the root label is a null string. We have seen here the root label is going to be a null string. DNS recognizes that children of a node have different labels, which guarantees the uniqueness of the domain name. And in domain name, each node in the tree has a domain name. A full domain name is a sequence of labels separated by a dots. The domain names are always read from the node up to the root. The last label is the label of the root. This means that a full domain name always ends in a null label, which means the last character is a dot because the null string is nothing. So we call it as a fully qualified domain name. A label is terminated by a null string, then it is called as fully qualified domain name. So in this fully qualified domain name that contains a full name of a host, it contains all labels from the most specific to the most general that uniquely defines the name of the host. Note that the name must end with a null label, but because null means nothing, the label ends with a dot. Next one, which we have shown in our screen, is partially qualified domain name. If a label is not terminated by a null string, it is also called as partially qualified domain name. A PQDN starts from a node, but it does not reach the root. It is used when the name to be resolved belongs to the same site as the client. So here, the figure shows the FQDN and PQDN. Now, what is a domain? A domain is a subtree of the domain name space. The name of the domain is a domain name of the node at the top of the subtree. Here, figure shows the some domains. Note that the domain may itself be divided into domains. So DNS is a protocol, and we know that it is going to used in different platforms. So in the internet, the domain name space is divided into three important sections: generic domain, country domain, and the inverse domain. So we will see here one by one. In generic domain, the generic domain defines registered host according to their generic behavior. Each node in the tree defines a domain, which is an index to the domain name space database. Looking at the tree, we see that first level in the generic domain section allows 14 possible labels. See, for example, AURO means it denotes the airline and aerospace computer. So if you are using NET, it means that it is a network support centers. So like this, we have 14 different possible levels at the first level of our generic domains. The next one is a country domain. The country domain section uses two characters for country abbreviations. For example, if you are using US, then it denotes the United States. The last one is the inverse domain. So inverse domain is used to map an address to the name. We know that when we have a name, you are going to map to the address. But we have to see when this vice versa cases will be happen. It may be happen. For example, when a server has received a request from the client to do a task. Although the server had a file that contained a list of authorized clients, but it will have only the IP address of the client, which is going to be extracted from the received IP packet, will be listed. Then the server will ask the DNS to send a query to the DNS server to map an address to a name to determine the client is on the authorized list. So the server that handle the inverse domains are also hierarchical. Now we will see the name address resolutions, that is resolver. DNS designed as a client server applications. So a host that need to map an address to a name or name to an address called a DNS client called a resolver. The resolver access the closest DNS server with a mapping request. If the server has the informations, it satisfies the resolver. Otherwise, it either refers the resolver to other server or ask other server to provide the informations. We are going to see these two types in detail. After the resolver receives the mapping, it interprets the response to see if it is a real resolution or an error, and finally delivers the result to the process that requested it. So first one is mapping name to address. Most of the time, the resolver give a domain name to the server and ask for the corresponding address. So in this case, the server checks the generic domains or country domains to find the mapping. The next case is mapping address to names. A client can send an IP address to a server to map to a domain name. As mentioned before, this type of query is called as a PTR query, that is inverse domain. So to answer the query, the DNS uses the inverse domain. So we have, as I have told you already, we have two types of resolution. One is recursive resolution and the other one is iterative resolution. So here the client can ask for a recursive answer from a name server. This means that resolver expects the server to supply the final answer. For example, the client will need an IP address of www.google.com. It will send the request to the local DNS server. So if the server is authority, then it will check the database and respond to the computer. If the server is not in the authority, it sends request to the another server and wait for the response. If the parent is the authority, it responds. Otherwise, it sends request to the yet another server. So again, here we have reached to com. So it will send request to the another server. So now we have reached to the Google server, which is the authority of the authority server. So when the query is finally resolved, the response travel back until it finally reaches the requesting client. So this type is called as recursive resolution. The next case is iterative resolution. The client does not ask for recursive answer. The mapping can be done iteratively. So if the server is an authority for the name, again it sends the answer. If it is not, it returns the IP address of the server that it thinks can resolve the query. So now we are going to send the request to the root domain server. It knows only the address of com. So it will send the address of the com to the IP address of the com domain server to the local DNS server. Now, again, the local DNS server is responsible for repeating this query to the second server. If the newly addressed server can resolve the problem, it answers the query with IP address. Otherwise, it will return the IP address of the new server to the client. Now the client must repeat the query to the third server. So this process is called as iterative resolution because the client repeats the same query to multiple servers. So then we have a question that each and every time whether we need to if you want to convert the name to IP address, whether we have to repeat this process. So to overcome this, here we have a concept called as caching. When a server asks for a mapping from another server and receives the information, first it is going to store the information in its cache memory before sending it to the client. So if the server is doing this operation is, if the same or another client asks for the same mapping, it can check its cache memory and solve the problem immediately. So these are all the concept of domain name system. So we have seen what is a domain name system, why we want to use domain name system, and how the names are going to be arranged, what is mean by domain, what is meant by label, and what are the different types of domains are available, and how to resolve the domain name system. Thank you.